state of Tennessee still says we're legally brother and sister, so don't worry. So I said, honey, where in the world would you want to go? So she started naming off places. I said, just anywhere in the world. She started naming off, you know, Greece and Hawaii. And I said, well, anywhere in this general vicinity, just tell me where you want to go. Well, I would like, I said, well, anywhere pretty much right there. So there's where we went. We went to a little place called Florida. We spent some days, just Tina and myself. And let me just tell you, when you lay your $3 flip-flops on the beach and go walking, nobody wants them. When you lay your chacos on the beach and go walking, you have to buy new chacos because somebody thinks they want them worse than what you do. So I had to buy some new chacos. Tina had to buy some new shoes because somebody decided they liked them pretty good. So, but you know, they have this saying that once you learn how to ride a bicycle, you never forget. That ain't all the way true. Tina and I were riding bicycles and we're just looking and there's trails everywhere. There's beautiful houses. And I look around and Tina's leg is doing this. And the bike's doing that. And she just goes right into this lady's bush. Just comes out, she got junk all in her hair, knees all scratched up and everything. I'm like, what happened, honey? Well, I ran off the edge of the sidewalk. Tina wrecked the bicycle right in the middle of town in this place. Just right, landed in some woman's bush, junk all over her hair, spiders and everything. But after I found out she was okay, I laughed. I didn't want to laugh until, but I was behind her and I'm like, you okay? You gonna be all right? But that's how we celebrate. We just beat each other to pieces. Gentlemen, if you would help us, we have missed Christ Point Church terribly. We stayed gone a little longer this time than we usually do. We missed you terribly. It's good to be back home. It's good to worship with our family. I am excited, excited, excited. If you are visiting with us today, we pray a prayer together. We will put it on this board, and we pray it out loud, and we pray it for the world to know. Raise your hand if this prayer has been effective in your life. It has mine. I'm a living example of how good God is. Let's pray this together for this morning's tithes and offerings. Pray with me as we receive this morning's tithes and offerings. We are believing you, our Lord, for provision and protection, jobs and better jobs, raises and bonuses, benefits, sales and commissions, favorable settlements and contracts, interest and income, rebates and returns, checks in the mail, gifts and surprises, money found and debts paid off, expenses decreased and blessings increased. And thank you, Lord, for meeting all of my financial needs so that I may have more than enough to give into the kingdom of God and promote the gospel of Jesus Christ. And we said together, amen. Amen. Thank you, gentlemen. Amen. An example of a Christian woman to her family, and I want to say, if on behalf of Dorcas and the Jones family, Sparky, Daniel, thank you for loving them, because I want you to know that we have an opportunity, there's a challenge before us, we have an opportunity to lead our families to the Lord, much like she did. Families can sit there and say, whether I choose to walk with the Lord or not, it's not because my mama didn't show me how. So thank the Lord for that. Thank the Lord. I want to say also that the man that led me to the Lord in 1988 went on home and graduated to be with the Lord last week. I wasn't able to, Tina and I had just left town. We didn't really even know how. He had a progressive state of Parkinson's and part of you. I had mentioned something that he said one time. I heard him say many times. I don't know if you've ever heard of who Sandy Patty is. If you're over 50, you probably know who I'm talking about. Sandy Patty, Christian singer, gospel singer. He said the first 10,000 years of my life, or my life in heaven, he said, I'm going to spend sitting next to Sandy Patty. Well, he can't do that because she's not dead. So, but I'd say he's probably enjoying himself tremendously. He pastored us. He led us to the Lord. And I will say that when we all get to heaven, I'm going to sit by this worship team is who I'm sitting by. So that's who I choose to sit by. But you know, it is, things happen. Things change so rapidly in our lives. And I want you to know that this morning, I want you to know, I'm going to give you a disclaimer. This is where God has led me. This is where God has planted me. And I'm not preaching this to step on anybody's toes, but I've always said this is the shoe fits, you got to put it on. So I want us to look at shacking up. Now, how many of you saw the graphic for the sermon? I like to kind of pique our curiosity a little bit. Shacking up. Now, this is what I want to put a little behind it that I didn't put on the graphic. Shacking up is where the vision dies. Shacking up. Now, you may think I'm going somewhere. I'm not going where you think I'm going. I promise you that. Let me begin by saying missionaries. Missionaries leave this country. Derek and LaShawn, Derek was a good friend of ours, led him to the Lord, worked with him in the ministry, went with the first time he spoke to anybody. Derek's been on the mission field most of the time I've ever known him. And I think of Derek when I say this. Missionaries leave this country for an extended period of time. They leave this country for years, sometimes 2-3 years. I think it's somewhere in a rotation of about 3 years before we'll see Derek again. They are in Papua New Guinea. And this is the general consensus of the missionaries that leave this country and come back. They say, we cannot believe the rapid moral decline that we have witnessed. They have been gone. They've been removed from it. They've been actually protected from it. They come back to our great United States of America, and they see that it is slidden downhill. It's like we have a little bit of a moral decline going on here, and it's happened quickly, and it's happened rapidly. But now, at the same time, we're like the frog that's in the pan. We're sitting there in the pan, and it happens all so slowly, we don't even know we're getting burned up. We're in the pan, the water's slowly being turned up, the temperature's slowly being turned up, and those things around us, we don't even notice these things happening. We see these, we look up, and all of a sudden somebody reminds us like a missionary and says, hey, I'm going to tell you something, things are going downhill pretty quick. So I want you to know, it can happen very quickly. We sense the water is getting hot, but we don't do anything about it. We stay where we are. This is where the vision dies. I want to reiterate the vision before I move on. And I just want us to know, Debbie and I'd gotten word that Debbie had got a word from the Lord, before I even mentioned the vision. That's what's so encouraging, because when I was told that last night, I'm like, yes, because it's confirmation that God is speaking to us and speaking to our hearts. The vision is to be a powerful presence in the community, to make a difference in people's lives, to accept people with their flaws and with their imperfections, accept people and know that everybody's imperfect until you come to this perfect Savior. You're never going to be perfect, but you have a perfect amount of blood applied to your life. That's what we're talking about, to reach thousands of people in a community that don't support that. There's no way you can reach 1,000 people in a community that don't have 5,000. I beg to differ. I don't know how. I can't explain it because that's God's thing. All I know is God's called us to do that. So, I want you to know, in going to where the vision is, I'm staying in Nehemiah, where the vision dies, whether it dies slowly like the frog in the pan or whether it dies quickly, the end result's the same. The vision's dead. The vision's dead. The end result is the same. And I want to stay in Nehemiah chapter 13 this morning. I want to stay there. I want to, all the verses will be from chapter 13. Nehemiah, I want you to go with me to 1. And I want us to look at where we are. And I'll pray that when you look at this, when you see this, that you say, thank God I've been delivered from this. Thank God that I'm not there. But if we're there, we've got some kicking out to do. So I want us to look at verses 1 and 2. On that day, they read from the book of Moses in the hearing of the people. And in it was found written that no Ammonite and no Moabite should ever enter the assembly of God. Now I'll back up, Wayne, if you don't care, and read that again. They were reading from the book of Moses in the hearing of the people, and it was found written. Now we are letting the people know what the law of what the righteousness that he requires is, the righteousness that his righteousness requires him to require. The Lord said, look, it was found written that no Ammonite or no Moabite should ever enter the assembly of God. Think about that. We're going to get all over that in just a second. For they did not meet the people of Israel with bread and water, but hired Balaam against them to curse them. Yet our God turned the curse against them into a blessing. No Moabite and no Ammonite will ever be accepted into the assembly. Now let me explain to you who the Moabites are and who the Ammonites were. See, we've got Moab, and we've got Ammon. We've got this whole ordeal going on with Sodom and Gomorrah and Lot. Now, if you've never heard that story, really I encourage you to read that. It's very interesting. We've got the story going on with Lot. God is about to destroy this city because of their wickedness. Now, I have heard it said that if God doesn't judge the world today, and it may have even been America, that he's going to have to rise up Sodom and Gomorrah and apologize to them. I say God's got to do what he wants. So I want you to know that there's a great wickedness going on. Lot, Abraham's nephew, he's living down there. That's part of his lifestyle. And God decides to rain down upon this place fire and brimstone and just wipe it from the face of the earth. But he says, Lot, you better get out while you've got time. I want you to get out. I want you to take your wife, your children, everybody you've got, take them and get out of here. And I don't want you to look back because I'm going to destroy this place. Well, as they were leaving, we all know the story. Poor old Lot's wife's got to look back. Somebody's always got to look back. She looks back, boom, she's turned to a pillar of salt. So all of a sudden, we've got a motherless society. We've got a father fleeing to the mountains with his children. You've got to go with me here and think about this. They literally thought, this is my interpretation, if you were in town and fire and brimstone's raining down upon your home, hailstones the size of bricks and the size of cars, fire coming down, everything burning up around you, and you're the only one that escaped, you think you have just experienced the end of the world. Now, they fled to the mountains. They're hiding out. They don't know that there's anything else alive in the world. So, some bad things begin to happen. They feel like that they're, you know, I'm kind of paraphrasing this, we're going to be childless, let's get our father drunk, let's have sex with him, and we'll have children. So this is where Moab came from, this one of the sons, and the other daughter had a son named Ammon. This is where they come from, incestual illegitimacies, where they came from. This is the fathers of the Moabites, the fathers of the Ammonites. They worshipped false gods. They didn't worship the Lord. They worshipped false gods. They refused Israel passage when Israel was had fled Egypt. They refused to take care of them. They refused to harbor them. These are enemies of Israel. They're threats to their way of life. No Ammonite, no Moabite shall ever enter the assembly of God. Nobody. Now that's the law. They lived by the law then. That's before Jesus. They lived by the law. Let's look at verses 4 and 5. I'm getting somewhere. I promise you I'm getting somewhere. It may take me a while to get there, but I'm going to get there. As soon as the people heard the law, they separated from Israel all those foreign descent. Now before this, Eliashib, the high priest, or the priest, who was appointed over the chambers. Now I want you to look that word over. He was appointed over. He was in charge of the chambers of the house of God, who was related to Tobiah. I want to bump off here just a second. He was related to Tobiah. In chapter 4, Tobiah was the one of the ones that was verbally assaulting Nehemiah and the Israelites as they were trying to rebuild. And he's the one that said, even if a fox jumped up on that wall, it'd knock it down. You guys are pathetic. Tried to verbally attack them. And in chapter 4, it says that he was an Ammonite. So, who was appointed over the chambers? Let's go back just a little bit, Gwen. I didn't finish it. I'm sorry. He was appointed over the chambers of the house of God, and who was related to Tobiah. This guy was placed in charge of the chambers of the temple of the house of God, and he was related to the Ammonite. Now let's go forward a little bit more. He prepared for Tobiah a large chamber where they had previously put the grain offerings, the frankincense, the vessels, the tithes of grain, the wine, the oil, which were given by commandment to the Levites, the singers, and the gatekeepers, and the contributions for the priests. Look at what's going on here. We've got the forbidden of God, the forbidden by God, shacking up in the house of God. This guy is shacking up in the house of God. Now let me tell you what has happened here. Nehemiah has come back. Nehemiah has come for the first time. He has heard of a great state of disgrace. The walls are in, the city's in terrible distress, and he comes back and orchestrates a quick month and a half or 2 month and a half building process that built back the walls and gave them dignity. So he's built back. He has governed over them for 12 years. Now he has left. Nehemiah's not there. He's left. He's went back to Susa. Some scholars say 2 or 3 years. You're not going to go that kind of distance in a quick time and get back. So he's gone for a good amount of time. And while he's gone, the man who is in charge of the church, the man who is in charge of the sanctuary, has cleaned it out and he's moved an Ammonite in, because this is where we are in today's society. I don't want to offend you, so I'll move you in. I don't want to offend you, so I'm going to move you in. I'm going to tell you something. We live in a country and a society today where to offend somebody is a crime. I'm sorry, we're offended in every walk of life. Everything that we go through in life, we have the ability, the opportunity to be offended. I'm offended by some of the things I saw last week. I'm offended by driving through Atlanta. Terribly, it offends me. I even said they should move Atlanta out of the way so people can get back and forth to Florida easier. It's ridiculous. And don't think I didn't look on the map and figure how I can go 5 hours out of the way to try to avoid it. And I might do that next time. But we live in a society where we're afraid to offend somebody. Now, to offend somebody by saying something terrible or ugly or nasty is one thing, but to be afraid to offend somebody because you're afraid to stand for what you believe is wrong. I stand for what I believe. I respect people who stand for what they believe, even though they're standing for, they may be standing for something that's totally wrong. At least they're standing for it. And I think that we need to make a stance and quit wavering back and forth. Tobiah was placed into an apartment in the temple because Eliashib, who was supposed to be over that, was afraid to offend him. Okay, yeah, you're my family. Okay, I'll fix you someplace. I'll fix it up for you. Don't worry. See, we've got the forbidden by God shacking up in the house of God. Verse 2 says, if we back up, they did not meet them with bread and water. They did not meet them with bread. This is one reason why you're not allowed to be in the assembly, because you didn't give safe passage. You didn't welcome with open arms the people of Israel when they needed you. You told them, no, you can't come through here. You got to go around that way. You can't come through here. You got to go around that. Life has got to be hard for you because I'm just not going to give in. I'm not going to give you safe passage or give you bread and water. Let me explain something to you. Anything that doesn't feed the presence of God should be separated from the assembly. In our homes, in our lives, anything that doesn't feed the presence of God should be separated from the assembly. Anything. The Levites. Levites were called. These are the people they're talking about, the priesthood, the Levites. Levites were called to carry the presence of God. It is your responsibility to carry the presence of the God of the Lord. It is your responsibility to worship before before the Lord on behalf of the people. It is your responsibility to make sacrifice on behalf of the people. It is your responsibility to worship on behalf of the people. The singers, these things were supposed to carry the presence to the people, carry the presence before the people and for the people. Let's look at verse 10. Let's look at verse 10. I also found that portions of the Levites had not been given to them, so that the Levites and the singers who did the work had fled each to his field. Now, Nehemiah's been gone. He comes back and he's like, I'm not liking what I'm seeing here. Now, if you keep reading, you'll find out he got pretty mad. He got mad enough. He beat some of them. He pulled their beards. He got mad. He wanted to make a statement. When the Levites are neglected, they are forced to go back to the fields. When the Levites are neglected, they're forced to go back to work. When the Levites are neglected, they're forced to go back to feed themselves and to feed their families. And now, I don't want this message to solely intend to be the church minister, but let me give you an example. If we don't take care of that minister sitting on that front pew right now, then let me tell you something, she'll be forced to go get a job somewhere. It is our responsibility to take care of her. She is a minister. She is the one that God has placed here. It is our responsibility. And I want you to know, I believe in that 100%. But let me give you an example. Let me give you some statistics. How many times have you driven down the road and you watched the preacher of the church mowing the yard? How many times, and I'm going to tell you something, if we had a parsonage right there, it'd be the mower of the yard. So you can't always judge that. She'd die if somebody else mowed her yard. I've never seen a time when she didn't mow it, didn't sit back and look at it like this. Make sure her lines are straight. Every time. That's how we roll at our house. But let me give you some statistics. Each month. Now this is staggering to me, and I want to digress just a little bit. I want to jump off on the church minister before I go to the home minister. I want you to go with me just for a second. Every month, 1,500 pastors leave the ministry. Every month. 1,500 pastors leave the ministry because of moral failure, because of spiritual burnout, contentions in their churches. 50% of pastors' marriages end in divorce. Man, that's a secular rate right there. 50% of all pastors end in divorce. Tina and I could go back into the 90s when we were in youth ministry, about as heavy as anybody could ever be. We'd go back and we can start naming people who we had association with. They're not even married anymore. These were the people who were district and state leaders that are not even married anymore. 50% of all pastors' marriages end in divorce. 70% of pastors constantly fight depression. 40% report that they have had extramarital affairs. And this is the church minister. This is the face of the church. Why in the world would you not attack the leadership if you were Satan? Why would you not attack the leadership and try your best to defeat him? If you can cut the head off the snake, then the rest of the snake dies. So I would attack the pastors if I was the devil. And I'm not going to talk about living with the devil. I said, boy, I just really want me to say, because I know what she's like, I live with her. But I'm not going to say that. And said, that's what you're thinking, man. That ain't right, everybody's done it. I appreciate that. That is, it is the church minister we're talking, the face of the church, the visionaries. Why not attack the visionaries and kill the vision? The gospel is under attack, people. This has not changed. It's been this way for a long time. It's been this way since the Lord laid out the plan of salvation. It's not changed. The gospel is under attack, and it's becoming, we're not living in such a safe haven anymore. The gospel is under attack, and you, I'm telling you right now, you can take your finger, and I want you to do it this way, then turn it back this way. You are the Levites in your home. You are the priesthood in your home. You are the gospel that's under attack in your home. You are the minister. You are the voice of the gospel. It is your responsibility. You say, no, Pastor, I'm not. That's your job. I've got an hour at best, maybe an hour and a half at best in the course of a week to spend with your family. It is your responsibility to be the priesthood in your home. If it is not your husband, it has got to be the wife. If it's not the wife, it's got to be the teenager. If it's not the teenager, it's got to be the little kid that's over there in Kids Point Ministry right now. It's got to be somebody. And in the absence of the Levite, in the absence of the minister, the Ammonites and the Moabites will symbolically move in and shack up. So when you take the absence of the leadership of God, Nehemiah, and think of yourself, when you take that away from your element of family, your element of life, then symbolically, that spirit of Ammon will shack up. And in Nehemiah's presence, the people failed. In the absence of the holy, people will fail. There's a second law of thermodynamics that says everything tends toward disorder. So let me make that plain. Anything left to itself will not get better. I'll give you an example. Leave your gutters, don't clean them out, and see if they clean themselves out. Anything left to itself will only get worse. We are not going to get better in this world without a divine intervention. That's what makes us better. That's what makes us become better people. Eliashib was in charge of the temple in Nehemiah's absence, much like we're in charge of our own temple. It is our responsibility. Either this temple, our home, however we want to look at it. And our home, it's not Steve, it's Tennessee. We do this together. We work on this thing together. Our home is established as a godly sanctuary because we do it together. In the absence of God, it won't be long until we move in foreign things. In the absence of God, we will move in foreign things. Those things that are forbidden by God. If you move out God, you will move in something else. Those things that are not conducive to our godly relationship with Him. Things that the minister pushes out to the fields. See, when you push something out to the fields, the minister gets pushed out to the field. The minister in you gets pushed out to the fields. And when you get something pushed out to the fields, it's not a threat to Satan anymore. It's out there. The temple is where he wants to attack. I want to run down some scriptures real quick. Verse 11. So I confronted the officials, this is Nehemiah, why is the house of God forsaken? We've got to ask ourselves, why is the house of God forsaken? Now this is not typical, I don't typically preach this kind of message. Why is the house of God forsaken? Why is the house, and look at ourselves, us being the spiritual leaders, us being the ministers, the priesthood in our very own homes, why is my home? If it is, then we ask ourselves, why is the house of God forsaken? Verse 19. As soon as it began, I want to tell you what's going on here. He comes in and he finds out there's no respect for the holy. There's no respect for the day of God. There's no respect for the Sabbath. They've not even got a respect for it. They're carrying on business. They're selling inside. It's just basically another day of commerce for them. As soon as it began to grow dark, at the gates of Jerusalem before the Sabbath, I commanded that the doors be shut and gave orders that they should not be opened until after the Sabbath. And I stationed some servants at the gates that no load might be brought in on that Sabbath day. He says, let me tell you something. I'm shutting it down. You're not going to be selling and making a disgrace of the Sabbath day. We have got to, before it's too late, we've got to shut the gate. Now, I'm going to tell you something. There are thousands and millions of people that are living an existence right now that says, where did I go wrong? What in the world has happened? Why are my children? Why are my grandchildren? Why is my family? Why is this? Where is that? All these, we've got to shut the gate before it's too late. We've got to shut it down. We've got to, before the Word says, before it was dark, before it's too late, before it's too dark, shut the gate, you're not getting in. Satan, you're not getting in. Verse 22 real quick. Then I commanded the Levites that they should purify themselves and come guard the gates. Levites, come out of the fields, get yourself back from where you are, get your mind from there back to here. My mind is somewhere else. I've drifted. I want to be somewhere else. I want to do something else. I want to be somewhere. I don't want to be in church anymore. I don't want to worship with people anymore. Get your minds from where you were. Get yourselves back over here. Purify yourselves and get back to work. Get back to work. When we shack up with the world, our lives become cluttered. It's going to happen. When we begin to start kicking out what doesn't fit. We start kicking out what doesn't fit. See, our lives become cluttered. Shacking up is where the vision begins to die, people. Things we are allowing to move in. These are the things that we are allowing to move in. These are the things that if they were in a society, in Nehemiah's day, he would call them a Moabite or an Ammonite. Things that attack our relationship. Now, in youth ministry years ago, I had this five teen killers. If I saw a teenager come in, they just love the Lord and get all excited about the Lord. These were the five things I could promise you was going to attack their relationship: boyfriend, girlfriend, job, sports, and mom and dad. Because I had seen this one just come to know the Lord. I mean, I've watched kids become leaders in worship and then get a boyfriend and never see them again. Boom. Sports. I've watched people let sports become a god in their life. All of a sudden, you don't see them anymore. Boom. Man, wonderful, wonderful. You got these children, they're serving the Lord, they're wonderful, they get 16. When you get 16, you got to get your car. When you get your car, you got to pay for gas. When you got to pay for gas, you got to get your job, and bye, I won't see you again. Jobs. Mom and dad, I've watched kids right here praying and seeking the Lord go home, and mom and dad say, you ain't doing that around me. You're not doing that. Some of them led their families to the Lord, and some of them, their families led them away from the Lord. I watched it, the killers. These things we're allowing to shack up. These things that we are allowing to shack up in our relationship, the wrong boyfriend and girlfriend. The wrong husband and wife. And you say, well, I'm already married. What do I do about it? The wrong husband or wife. In other words, you should have been thinking about that to start with. The wrong husband or wife. In other words, if you are trying to serve the Lord and the husband or the wife is pulling against you, then that's going to try to pull you away from the Lord. You've got to be the stronger puller. Things that attack our relationship, we're allowing to shack up. Sports, jobs, money, frustration, lack of resolve, complacency. Oh my word, I don't have enough time to preach about that one. Complacency. Personal insecurities, False security. Let me explain to you about that one. False security. We rebuilt our walls 12 plus years ago. Nehemiah built those walls. We established our protection. We have a false sense of security. We can do what we want to now. Nehemiah's not here anyway. Let's just stick somebody else in. Let's stick an Ammonite in the presence of the Lord. Let's just see how long God stays around. Let's just do that. We cannot let our guard down, people. We don't have the luxury of letting our guard down today. Our families are dying around us. We don't have that luxury. Number 10, proximity. Let me explain to you what I mean by that. We have this mentality in the world today that if it don't affect my little circle of influence, I don't care. Well, you know, they're doing this over there, but it really don't affect my world. So I'm okay with it. If they want to pay, if they want to pass a law that says that people can marry whoever they want to, I'm okay. It don't affect me. Yes, it does affect us. It does affect us. I've heard people say, well, you know, that don't matter to me. It don't affect me. Proximity, tolerance. See, tolerance. There's a big difference between loving people where they are and accepting people's idols and accepting people's lifestyles. There's a big difference between saying, look, I love you. I don't want to offend you. I love you. I don't want to offend you, but I'm not going to take a chance on offending my God either. So I love you, and I want you to know this much. I don't support your idols, whatever you're worshiping. I don't want to worship that. I've had people come into my life. They didn't want to be saved. They just want to infect. They want to bring their worship in. So no, we can't do that. You worship a different, well, this guy was a devil worshiper, so I just like, you know, we're done talking. You're not here for me to lead you to the Lord. You're here to infect, and I'm not going to allow it to happen anymore. So, there's a big difference between loving people where they are. I love you. I want to bring you to the throne of God. I'm going to bring you to me. I'm not the answer. I want to bring you to the cross. That's where I want to bring you, and I'm not going to accept that your lifestyle is something that I want, because I can't. I can't accept that. I love you where you are. Good things. Let me talk about good things, and I'm going to move right on. Good things we allow to shack up. I've seen good things come in. I've watched good things come in. I've watched kids, they try out, they make the AAU team. Man, that's good. You make the AAU team. That means you're going to travel. That means I will never see you again. I watched families go weekend after weekend after weekend to go play ball, and I'm going to tell you what, there's not one of them that I can think of that stayed in church. Not one of them. Good things, jobs. Oh man, God gave me a good job. I want this job. I applied for this job. It's a great job. It's a good job. But you know what? I never saw my children. They grew up. I worked every day and every night. Sometimes good jobs. Sometimes money's not a better job. Better money's not a better job sometimes. Some of these good things can come in. When we shack up with the wrong things, we allow the spirit of Ammon to shack up. Then our relationship is in jeopardy. When we allow the spirit in, when we allow that spirit in, someone or something else has to go. We were talking about this last night. You take your good old glass of Southern iced tea, and you put you some ice in there, and I'm going to tell you something. You put too much ice in, and the tea comes out. Well, I don't want to drink the ice. I want to drink the tea. So let me tell you something. If I keep putting stuff in there, something else has got to go out. So something's going to go out. Nehemiah chapter 13. Let's look at verse 5. I want to look at this real quick as we finish. He prepared for Tobiah a large chamber where they had previously put grain offerings. Now, this is what we took out in order to bring in the unholy, the forbidden by God. We took out the grain offerings, the frankincense, the vessels. We took out the tithes of grain, the wine, the oil, which were given by commandment to the Levites. They were given to the singers. They were given to the gatekeepers and the contributions for the priests. They were intended to take care of the priesthood. The priesthood, When we remove these things out, the priesthood, the word in our lives, we remove the word in our lives. The worshipers, the close intimacy with Christ, we move it out. The gatekeepers, the protection from Satan. We remove these things, and when they're removed, according to verse 5, these things are kicked out so the spirit of Ammon can shack up. So if we're shacking up with the wrong things in our lives, I'm going to tell you something. It's going to start being noticed. It's going to start coming to the surface. Let me explain to you what they mean, and I'm going to go quickly. The grain offering. Now I want you to go with me. The grain offering. This was what was taken out. We're going to take out so we can move in. We take out so we can move in the spirit of Ammon. The grain offering was taken out. It is a sacrifice of wheat or of barley. It could be cooked or not. There was a little bit more of a loose presentation in the sacrifice. It didn't have to be cooked, could be, could not. But it had to be finely ground. It had to have olive oil and salt. When we lose our salt, we lose our effectiveness. When we lose our effectiveness, we lose our ability to transform other people. We lose our ability to affect other people. Salt's one of the only things that does not change when you put something else with it. Salt changes everything that it touches. Put some salt in something and see if it don't taste saltier. Salt changes everything. When we lose our salt, we lose our effectiveness. So immediately, we pull out our salt, our flavor. We pull it out. And it says that it had to be finely ground. Now that wheat or that barley had to be finely ground into a powder. Now what that means is it is a process of growing in the Lord. When we remove that process of growing in the Lord, we bypass that change in our lives. We bypass that. We bypass the change that God makes in our lives. We say, I'm going to move this in. In order to move this in, I'm going to move out the refining that God does in me. I'm going to remove the change that God makes in my life. Now I've lost my effectiveness and I've lost my change. Frankincense. Frankincense was the next thing that was moved out. It was burned to emit a sweet fragrance. A lot of times it was burned to make a whiteness or a cloud. It was burned so that it could become an emblem of prayer. It was a symbol of the divine name of God. It became a symbol or an emblem of prayer. When the incense or the frankincense was burning, then that was the time that the prayer was going on. When we lose our fragrance, we lose that intimacy of prayer. See, this is the thing that's taken out so the spirit of Ammon can move in. We move that out. Okay, that we no longer have that intimacy of prayer. We lose the identity of the divine. We lose the identity of the divine. I no longer have that glow about me. I no longer have that presence of God about me. I may carry the name of a Christian, but I no longer have that intimacy, that closeness with Him. I've moved that out in order to move this in. The vessels. Vessels were used and designated to hold a dry or liquid product. It was used to serve in the temple. When we move something else in, then what gets moved out, we lose the ability to be poured into. We lose the ability to be poured into. So let me tell you what, when someone begins to start wanting to pour into your life, now how many of us can think of somebody right now, we'd love to pour the Lord into their life, but they're so frustrated. They're so I don't want to hear about God because I'm so. I've got my defenses up. That's the first thing that happens is we lose our ability to be poured into. Don't want to. I lose that ability. Lose the concept of serving others. How many of us can see when we move these things in, this gets moved out. That servanthood gets moved out, and we become more narcissistic. We become less serving others and more serving me. Everybody needs to think the way I think. The tithe. Tithe means a tenth. Also means a seed. When we withdraw our tithe money, we lose that sacrificial portion of our relationship. You say, well, I don't think tithe's that important. I think it is. Because money, we hang on to that stuff, man. It's very important to us. We want that. When we give what's important to us, we're giving. Hannah in the Bible, she gave what was important to her. She gave her son. She gave. When we give of that, it's a sacrificial relationship. We sever our blessing. We're not just severing what we're giving, we're severing our blessing. Lord, I'm saying I'm going to move the spirit of Ammon in, and I'm going to move out my blessing. I don't need a blessing anymore. I'm going to move that out. We rob our children of the future. We rob our posterity of the seed. We rob our posterity of their godly relationship. Number five, the wine. Wine means provision. Wine represents the provision of God, from God. When we lose the provision, we become vulnerable. We got to go back to the fields. When I'm not being taken care of in my relationship with the Lord, if I'm not cultivating that relationship with the Lord, you know what's going to happen? Something else is going to move in. Something's going to be pushed out. And I'm going to go to the fields. My mind's going to be somewhere else. I'm going to start drifting away from the Lord. I don't want to do that. Number six, the oil. Man alive. The anointing. The anointing is covering. It is what covers us. I can promise you this much. You take this worship team and you put them up here, and I can tell you this much. There is 100% consensus that says, I don't want to do this outside of the anointing. I'm not going to go up here and start playing and singing just for the sake of making some noise. I've got more things to do than that. You remove the anointing, and I promise you, they're going to filter out. The anointing is everything. Shack up with the spirit of Ammon and kiss your anointing goodbye. That's as simple as it is. Worship team, if you would come. Now that I'm talking about you, come. I want to recap. Israel had its dignity restored. Israel has basically went from a distressed state. They've had their temples been rebuilt. Their walls have been rebuilt. They're establishing themselves as a nation. They've got commerce going on. The wall, I mean, they feel secure. The wall's built. It's been this way for a while. Nehemiah has been governing as the governor of the land over them for 12 years. Nehemiah leaves, and he leaves for more than likely a period of years to make that trek and to get back. In his absence, an idol worshiper, not idol worship, but an idol worshiper. The abomination, the person, the thing that God says, I don't want. An idol worshiper has been moved into the temple. His name is Tobiah. It says point blank that he's an Ammonite. He has attacked them from day one, and they have moved him in. The ministers have been forced out. They're gone. They're not ministering in the temple. There is no worship. You don't walk through the city and hear worship in the temple. You don't hear this. You don't hear singers. You don't see preparation, provision being made to sacrifice. None of this is happening. They've had to go out and go to work. The Sabbath had become just another day. Just another day. Just another day. Sabbath, Sunday, Saturday, whatever you want to call it. Some worship on Saturdays, some worship on Sundays. I say pick a day. The Sabbath, just another day. It's not like any other day anymore. The temple had become just another building. Tobiah was in charge of it, and it's just another building, and I can take just another building. It's not anything special. I can make apartments out of it, and I can stick some people in there. 1,500 pastors are leaving their ministry as we speak. Their churches are being turned into apartments right now. Their churches are being leveled. Their churches are being transformed. They're being turned into apartments. Some are being bought. Some are being turned into other churches. The people had allowed the Ammonite to shack up in the house of God. They had allowed the Ammonite to shack up in the house of God. And in order to do that, something had to go. When something comes in and your glass is full, something's got to go out. And this is what went out. They lost their effectiveness. They lost their intimacy with God. They destroyed their seed. They lost their servant's heart. They lost their provision from God, and they lost their anointing. I'm not willing to give these things up. I'm not willing to sacrifice these things for you or for me. I'm not willing to. If we allow the enemy to shack up, if we allow him to shack up in our lives, then we will lose these same things. If our existence is a mess, if we've allowed the enemy to come in and to shack up, then we've got to do something to make that different. And I want to look at a scripture before we close. Let's look at 7, 8, 9. Because we're not going to end where we are. We're going to end in a victorious manner. And came to Jerusalem, and then discovered the evil that Eliashib had done for Tobiah. This is Nehemiah's writing this from like an autobiographical issue. He says, I came to Jerusalem. I discovered the evil that Eliashib had done. He put the Tobiah in there. And all this stuff had happened. He prepared for him a chamber in the courts of the house of God. I saw this happen and I was very, very angry. And I threw all the household furniture out. I threw Tobiah out and I threw everything out. Then I gave orders and they cleansed the chamber. And I brought back there the vessels. I brought back to the house of God. I brought back the grain offerings and the frankincense. I reestablished these things, he said. He says, look, let me tell you something. He said, I want you to look at what he says here. I want you to look real close. I gave orders that they cleanse the chambers. I brought back the priesthood. I brought back the Levites. And I said, you clean the chambers, but let me tell you something, people. God cleans the chambers, but it's our job to throw out the spirit of Ammon. It is our job to kick him out. God will help us kick him out, but it's our job. It is our responsibility. In my life, if I expect my family to have any existence with the Lord whatsoever, I better start doing some kicking out. I better start doing some cleansing. I better ask the Lord, Lord, allow me to be the priesthood in my life and let me start kicking these things out. It is my job to kick them out. It is my responsibility. Recognize it, chase it off, and restore the relationship. There's nothing else. There's nothing else. I want you to stand with me. And I want you to know, thank you, Pastor Kerry. Two or three tall men said, well, we've been challenged. Pastor Kerry had us at the altar and he's challenged us. See, I'm not that type of pastor that wants everything to fall apart when we're gone. We don't work that way. We work as a team. And these men like Brother Tom, Pastor Kerry, and we've got some of the most wonderful individuals here that make sure they care about you and your family. They care. People who are teaching, people who are facilitating small groups, they care about your families. And here is my challenge to you. What needs to be kicked out? Is there a spirit of Ammon? Do we need to pray for somebody else to kick that spirit of Ammon out of their house? What are we tolerating? And like I said, you know, I gave you a little bit of disclaimer. You know, if you're going to be mad, get mad at the Lord. He's going to give it to me. But I want you to be honest with yourself. Where are you with your walk with the Lord? What are you harboring and what are you needing to kick out? Because I want to tell you something. I don't care if you're pastoring this church, you might need to be kicking something out. We have to do a daily inventory. It's not something we do once every 10 years. We need to do this on a daily basis and determine what needs to be kicked out. It is our responsibility with our heads bowed and our eyes closed. Let's get first things first. How's your relationship with the Lord? How is your relationship with the Lord? Do you have a cultivated relationship with the Lord? Do you know Him as your personal Lord and Savior? Have you asked for forgiveness? Have you sought that redemptive power of the Lord? Have you asked God, please forgive me of my sins? If you haven't, I want you to let me know. Please, Pastor, help me right now. I want to pray, and I want you to know I'm going to make it easy for you. So raise your hand if you want to do that this morning. Raise your hand if you want to do that. There's one. Thank you. Is there another that says, I need to pray and seek the Lord this morning? I want my church family to pray with me. Is there another? Because I want us to pray out loud. We're going to help. We work like a team here. So I want you to pray with me. Pray out loud. Dear Lord. Come on, help me a little bit. Give me some light. Dear Lord.
Dear Lord.
I like that better. Dear Lord, thank you.
Thank you
for your goodness.
Thank you
for the Word.
Thank you
for showing me what needs to be kicked out. Lord, I ask you to restore the joy of my soul. Help me to start kicking things out. Lord, in the name of Jesus, I come before you, asking you to forgive me of my sins, creating me a pure heart, renewing me a right spirit. In your name I pray. Amen. Amen, amen. And with your heads bowed and your eyes closed, if you prayed that for the first time, raise your hand and let me know. If you prayed that, there's one. Thank you for being honest. Is there another? Thank you. I prayed that. I meant that. I'm not playing around. I want to walk with the Lord. I want to talk to Him. I want to know Him in the power of His of His resurrection. I want to know Him into the fellowship of His sufferings. I want to know Him. So I ask you, help me. I want you to know that the altar's open. I want to give you an opportunity. Now we've had a salvational prayer, but now somebody may say, look, I need a touch of healing. I need that oil anointed upon me. I need somebody to hold my hand. I need a financial breakthrough. I need something in my life. I just need to thank God for how good He is in my life. The altar's open. As this wonderful anointed worship team begins to start playing and singing, I want you to know that your altar before your God is open and it is ready for you to come before the Lord.
thank you so much for the word. Let us take it home with us, God. This is huge. We love you. We appreciate you with us, God. Just move things out our way.